my 20,000 package of emergency food in 2 hours. Now, to do all that, we need everyone. We need all hands on deck. Well, there is a role for everyone, regardless of your ability. You can participate. From the youngest to the most senior, there's labeling, there's counting, there's packing, there's carrying, there's pouring, there's something for everyone. It is controlled chaos. It is so much fun. And now I want you to think about the impact. 20,000 people will have a meal because of you. 20,000 people will not go to bed hungry. Will have the sustaining meal they need for that evening to keep hoping as we change the world. Or imagine a village of 2,000 people. How much life-sustaining nutrition they'll receive if they receive 20,000 meals. It is truly a blessing. If you want to contribute financially, $29, we ask that you contribute. You can write Wilmington United Methodist Church on your check, and then write in the memo line, Stop Hunger Now. But we hope everyone will stay. It's a lot of fun and fellowship, a lot of energy, and it makes a huge difference. 5:45 this evening, there will be a prayer vigil at a prayer for peace at the St. Thomas that all the community churches are participating in. If you need directions, talk to me. I'll let you know how to get there. What a gift it is to do that, especially if you turned on the news yesterday or today and heard the bombing in New Jersey, then the one in New York. We really do need to gather as people of faith and pray for peace. So we invite you to be a part of that as well. Some other quick announcements. On the 25th, there will be a fire drill. Mark that on your calendars. Also, I've started again why we do what we do as a part of our bulletin, so you can learn about how we worship and why. This week's on passing of the peace. I invite you to read why and we pass the peace and what it means. On the next page is a blurb about our theme. Our theme this year is intersections, to see what you can learn about that. Also, I want to make, just as we sell Christmas trees this year, we'll be selling pumpkins. It'll go for our youth group mission trip. The youth group spoke at the last service and led the last service for their two mission trips. We had 20 youth go to West Virginia in the high school, and we had 10 youth in the middle school go to Vermont, and they shared their story and their mission, their passion. So get your pumpkins here this year. We had a yard sale yesterday for our Lowell Wish Project. Over $1,000 was raised. Thank you for all who helped and contributed with that. Also, two more announcements. St. Paul's on the 27th, if you will help serve or help cook to serve the poor for the soup kitchen, please sign up on the bulletin board as you leave the sanctuary. And on October the 1st, we're having a special meal to raise money for St. Paul's. It's going to be here at the church. If you need a ticket, see the church office for that. And maybe some people running around here in Stop Hunger Now will have some tickets. So not only do we feed people internationally, we feed people locally. There are other things in the bulletin. I invite you to look at those. Now let us open our hearts, our minds, our spirits to Christ's presence as we worship God.
Praise the Lord. Praise, O servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord.
Blessed be the name of the Lord from this time on and forevermore.
From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised.
The Lord is high above all nations, and his glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God, who is seated on high, who looks far down on the heavens and the earth?
He raises the poor above, raises the poor from the dust, and lifts the needy from the ash heap, to make them sit with princes and with princes of his people. Praise the Lord. Our hymn.
Hi guys, how are you today? Doing well? I am glad. Look, you got your grandmother with you today. Is that right? Is that pretty special? That really is cool, isn't it? Do you like fruit?
Some fruit.
What's your favorite fruit?
Pineapple is really good.
What about you?
Strawberry.
That's my wife's favorite too. She loves strawberries. Strawberries are good. I like bananas. Bananas are good too. You like bananas?
Somewhat. You don't like all that good potassium? Oh my God. How about apples? My daughter, Ashley's favorite is apples. You like apples?
Yeah.
How about apple pie? Is that considered fruit still? You don't like apples? How can you not like a pumpkin pie?
Yeah.
Pumpkin or fruit? I think a pumpkin's a vegetable. I don't think that counts. You know, there's some interesting fruits. Have you ever heard of a kumquat?
No.
That's a fruit. Did you know that? And there's a dragon fruit. Have you ever heard of dragon fruit?
Yeah.
Yeah. How about a jackfruit? Have you ever heard of a jackfruit? Yeah. Jackfruit is like this big. It's huge. I've never actually eaten a jackfruit. Has anyone out here ever actually eaten a jackfruit? I don't know how it tastes either. But there are some interesting fruits, right? Well, today's Bible passage that we'll be talking about has some really good fruit. I want you to listen. I'm going to read part of the passage, and you tell me all the fruits that you hear. Okay? See, it's in the Bible. It's in Galatians chapter 5. It's 22 through 25, but we're only going to read part of it here, okay? Galatians is in the back of the Bible. It's one of the letters that Paul wrote. And you go all the way back here like this, Corinthians, and after Corinthians, we'll find Galatians. Oh, there it is. And we're going to Galatians chapter 5. And I'm going to, okay, you ready to put a good name in fruit? Let's practice. I'm going to say banana and apple. What fruits did I name?
Banana and apple.
Pear and jackfruit, what did I say?
Pear and jackfruit.
All right, you like pears? I like pears. You don't like pears? What about peaches? Everyone likes peaches. Oh, peaches are great. Okay. I'm going to read you name all the fruit, okay? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, fruitfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things. What fruits did I name? Okay, you didn't catch it. Let me try again. Okay, pay attention. You're really good at this, right? Let's practice again. Apples and grapes.
Apples and grapes.
Plums and dragon fruit.
Plums and dragon fruit.
Okay, you got them. So you're pretty good at this, right? Okay, I'm going to name the fruits again. You tell me which ones, okay? I'm going to read fruit. Okay, he writes about fruit right here. He says, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There are no laws against such things. Which fruits do you name? Did you listen very closely? One more time. Name the fruits. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control.
Love, joy, peace.
Oh, you're good. Oh, you're good. Paul says that those are the fruit of the Spirit. And what he means is those are the good things that we get from God. When we spend time in prayer and study and service, God gives us these things, and they're like the fruit of life. They're all the joy and the goodness of life, all the yumminess of life, and all the things that we really want and crave. So maybe if St. Paul was writing it today, he would say the chocolate of life instead of the fruit of life. or the dessert of life. But back then, back there, they didn't know chocolate, so he used fruit. So all the good things in life, if you follow God, spend time in prayer, help others, or study, these are the gifts that you get. These are the fruit, all the good things in life that you're going to get. Joy, love, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. You want those things, right? Yeah. Who doesn't want love, joy, and peace, right? Who doesn't need patience and kindness, right? Right? You want these things. So as we listen to God and follow God and pray and serve others, we get these gifts. Aren't they incredible? Oh, they're so incredible. Now, today we won't have Sunday school because your Sunday school teacher, Miss Janice, is actually going to be speaking in a few minutes. You're going to want to hear her speak, don't you? She's really good, right? And she's got three friends who are also going to be speaking. So we're going to listen to them speak, okay? But first, we're going to have a prayer. Let's pray together. Dear God, thank you that not only do we have the fruit that we like to eat like apples, but we also have the fruit of your Spirit. Give us more fruit of your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Now we're going to pass the peace, so I invite everyone to turn to David and share the peace. You guys can pass the peace and then go back and get ready to hear Miss Janice in a few minutes.
Service today, we're celebrating our adult mission trip to Vermont, and 2 years ago we took some adults to Vermont and had a great time, did some wonderful work. So this year four of our adults went back with a larger mission trip for some other churches, and they did some important work. So we're going to let them share. We're going to hear from Mary Ellen and Ron first, and then we'll have some more of the service, and then we'll hear from our last two mission trippers. And pay attention, because we may be going again next year, and there's always a spot for you.
Good morning. Ron, Janice, Deb, and I went to Waterbury, Vermont, to help do some more work on the Wesley Methodist Church. The year before, Janice, Ron, and I had been a part of the work crew, and we hung ceilings and hung wooden stringers and put up drywall and pasted baseboard out. It was a lot of work. It was a lot of fun. This year, our projects were to get the metal stud stringers on and hang commercial-grade drywall onto the stringers, and we finished drywalling the kitchen area, which was kind of tricky because we had pipes sticking out and big beams going through, and we had to use one of those, what was it called, a reciprocating straw with one of the laser beams and cutting it out and trying to paste it all together onto the wall. It was very tricky. We also installed two shower stalls with cement wallboard that I think Deb really had a hard time getting those screws in there because it's thick stuff. And Ron and Janice also helped to build up the base of a porch and make it so that it wouldn't fall through when people came up to the parsonage. It was at the parsonage next door to the church. It was in dire need of replacement, but we just didn't have the people or the supplies to do it, so that was somebody else's doozy of a job to do later. We bonded with the mission trippers right away. We knew some of them from the year before, Lowell, John, and Margaret, and we met a new lady named Tanya, and she had so many skills, and I felt so blessed to know her because she taught everybody how to do so many things. She helped everybody out, and everybody else helped everybody out with the cooking and the cleaning and the finding of the tools and the right tool for the right job and how to do it and making sure everybody was getting enough water and enough breaks and enough rest. I didn't lose my gloves this year, so I was happy about that. The first day we were on the mission site, it was hot and muggy, and boy, were we just sweating buckets. We had to have drink after drink after drink breaks. But we were so tired, but we felt so accomplished by the end of the day because we got so much done, even though we were just working our little tails off. I felt we were really blessed to have very knowledgeable people show us the easiest ways to do the job. And the week was accented by us being blessed by other people coming and getting us sweet treats. We got cheesecake, we got cookies. People brought us barbecue lunches, and we had a beautiful potluck supper. It was just blessings upon blessings. And Kathy also made us pillowcases again, so now I have matching pillowcases, so it's nice. The congregations of Waterbury and Northfield were so caring and so kind to us. I felt blessed just being there. Also, there was a man there named Bob. And I felt especially blessed by him. He was working two other jobs to make ends meet, and he came and helped us out in his free time. And we wondered sometimes if he even took time out in his day to eat. So whenever he came at lunch, we were like, here you go, come have some lunch with us. He was amazing in his devotion to his church family, and we all liked and admired him very much. We had devotional times when we were at what's the place where we stay? Mackenzie House. We had devotional times when we were at Mackenzie House, and learning how to pray is a wonderful thing, and many people were very good at that, and we learned about praying, and we also learned about new ideas on what it means to be in mission. And one of the ideas that Tanya talked to us about was that my actions are my prayer, so I took that with me. The highlight of my week was the hymn sing-along. I love to sing, so it was very moving, and there were so many of us, we sounded like a choir. We sounded so nice. I encourage anyone who wants to go on an adult mission trip, just sign up and talk with any one of us. It's a blessing to go. Thank you.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning,
John. Ditto. No, we worked at the church for about maybe half a day, and then they sent us over to the parsonage. And when we got to the parsonage, oh, it was all rotted out. Everything looked like it was going to fall down. The boards on it, you put your hand on it, and they crumbled. It was terrible because of neglect. Everything was all neglected for years and years. And we did what we could. We were limited with people and work, and it was terrible. But we accomplished what we could do, and we felt really great at what we did. And that's about it, you know? I mean, the next team that was coming in, they had more people, more experienced people, you know? And there were, yeah, so that's about it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'd like to invite one of our lay leaders, Jenny Hipple, to come forward. Last week we got to see a little bit of Tabitha as she led worship with us, but this week we officially welcome her with blessing to the service. All who take upon themselves the name of Christ are called into ministry of love and service by the example of Christ.
We welcome Tabitha into our community as she begins her work as an intern. We pray the blessings of God in this community in our shared ministry. We celebrate your ministry as an intern and dedicate you to serve in our community. Through our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our talents, we will be united with you in your work. May God richly bless your labors.
Let's give an official welcome and thank you. And I want you to talk to her during Stop Hunger Now. Get to know her. She's a wonderful soul and a beautiful addition to our church. You heard part of our scripture reading with the children and children's time. I invite you now to turn in your pew Bibles or look on the screen to Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 through 25 as we hear the entire lesson. One that's probably familiar to many of you as you hear the fruits of the Spirit. But today I invite you to listen with new ears to hear what the Lord has to say to us through this lesson. By contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things. And those who belong to Christ Jesus has crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also be guided by the Spirit. This is the word of our Lord. Amen. I'd like to invite our last two speakers on the mission trip to come forward, Deb and Janice.
We had a great time. I really wanted to go last year, but I couldn't get the time off from work, so I put in really early this year. As the newcomer in the group, people couldn't have been more welcoming. I've never seen so many power tools in my entire life. My gifts lie in knitting and crocheting and sewing, not so much cutting and lifting and using the power tools. However, anything I wanted to learn, there was somebody there to teach me. So I would encourage everybody to try to do this at least once in your life, because just as this afternoon there's something for everybody to do, we never ran out of things to do on the trip. And it was so wonderful because there was not an argument or a crossword the entire week amongst this group of strangers. We just all came together. We had a purpose. We finished the kitchen. Anytime you needed an extra set of hands, you didn't even have to ask because somebody would have noticed and was there helping you. The gentleman, Bob, that Mary had spoken about, this flood was 5 years ago, and people are still recovering. This gentleman had lived in a mobile home that was flooded out. So he was able to purchase a new home, and someone purchased his old flooded home. And the woman did not have much money, and the contractor she hired took the money and ran. Bob, in his generosity, helped that woman again in his spare time redo the house so she had a place to live with her children. This is the type of faith-filled people that we met in Vermont. We had so much hospitality. People would stop in, they would just stop in and say hello, to visit, to drop us off treats. We all gained weight. but I think what struck me was just 5 years into this, people still had the faith that it would be finished. And the fellowship hall of this church was so important to that community because not just that church used it, but all different kinds of groups. 4-H, Boy Scouts, different community groups, everybody was waiting for this hall to be done so that the community could continue on. And I do have to thank the conference for forward thinking, because Mackenzie House, where we were able to stay, was a wonderful facility. It had been a fellowship hall for a church that closed, and they turned it into dormitories. Without that facility, it would be really difficult for groups to come up and work. I think there probably had been three groups before us that summer, and there was one following us. So the work was able to continue, and that in itself was a blessing, that you were part of something that had already been started, you did your part, and you passed it on to the next group. So I can't say enough, we should all try to go back.
Thank you. This was my second time going on mission trip, and I was always so envious of my children when they got to go on the youth trips that now it's mommy's turn. So, and I found out that I have an affinity for power tools. I love power tools. I have used saws now, compound miter saws, things that throw things into the wall. I don't even know the names of all the tools, but I love them all. And the gift of the mission trip, too, is the kindness of the people that you work with. I had the blessing 2 years in a row to work with Ron, who is very kind and gentle and explains things without making you feel like you're silly and don't know what's going on. Everyone has the patience there. I obviously am not a carpenter, as Deb was saying. You know, I can crochet a mean blanket, but I've never hung drywall and all of that. But now I can say I have, and you do it in such a comfortable place that it empowers you and lets you know that you have the capacity inside you to do this. It's all the wonderful gifts. And the fellowship that you meet, the people that you meet are so wonderful. The church that we worked in, Waterbury, has a congregation of 50 people, all total, 25 are active, and the average age is 65. So they're an aged church. And what they do is they work with the other churches in the community, so there's a lot of blending and wonderful fellowship that happens amongst the churches. They share pastors and they share services and stuff. So it was such a gift to be able to see that and experience that. And you see all of these gorgeous churches that were made with these beautiful woodworking, and now I'm thinking, I can probably do some of this, you know? Not quite. But I've decided to take on some projects at our house. My home is almost 200 years old, so my husband and I are now working on some things in the house, and I'm getting myself a tool belt. And you know, it's just the beginning. Ron is gonna be a nice little asset for me. I'm sure I'll be giving him a call and asking for help along the way. But I would really like to encourage people to try and plan on attending one of these adult mission trips. They are phenomenal. Another thing that we had this year, we had a father and son come. The son was in high school. And as long as the parent accompanies the child, then you are welcome. This is volunteers and mission, and that's their rules. But what a wonderful bonding experience it is for a parent and a child to come. So if, you know, I hope and pray that you think about it, consider it. The gifts that you receive far outweigh anything that you expend, any energies that you expend or sweat or worry or anything. The gifts that you receive back are tenfold. So I hope you'll consider it. And if you have any questions, all four of us would love to chat with you about it. Thank you.
Amen.
It sounds like to me the theme for the mission trip should be go for the cookies, stay for the service. No, I should. I gained weight 2 years ago when I went as well. Don't let that stop you. When I was appointed to this church, I received the church profile. It is a form filled out by the staff parish committee that describes this church and its ministry. And I remember receiving it in the mail and taking the packet with me and going to get in the line to pick up my daughter from school. And as I was seated there waiting for her to get out, using my thumb to open up the manila packages you were sending, pulling out the paperwork and reading about this church. And as I read it, I was amazed by the many ways that this church serves in mission. Not only were there so many ways the church was involved, but it seemed that at every level the church was engaged. Over the years that I have served here, I have continued to be amazed by this church's commitment to mission. Those who can go, be it to the soup kitchen or a mission of deeds or the dwelling place or a mission trip, they go. Those who can't go offer support, be it cooking or cleaning or praying or providing the much needed financial resources. We are a people of mission. We have heard God's call and we serve. Today we have heard from four different people who went to Vermont. We have heard of the life-changing power of service for those we serve and for those who serve. Later we will hear, we will all have the opportunity to participate in a service through Stop Hunger Now. I hope that you all participate. We need everyone. It will be powerful. It will be fun. And best of all, there's a role for each of us. In our world, there are so many people who don't serve because they fill their lives with the I can'ts and the I'm twos. You know the I'm twos. I'm too old. I'm too young. I'm too busy. I'm too tired. I'm too poor. I'm too fill in the blank. It reminds me of a story I've once heard. Maybe you've heard this story too. It's a wonderful story about a man who was so busy running from one place to the other, he lived by his watch. One day he needed to run into the store to get something, so he ran in, hurried, and as he walked in the door, he heard sirens start to blare, and he looked around, and lights were starting to flash from anywhere. Then he felt confetti falling on him, and as he shook it out of his eyes looking around, he finally saw a big blinking sign that said, 1 millionth customer. The manager of the store approached him and shook his hand vigorously, saying, "Congratulations, you are our 1 millionth customer, and indeed this is a great honor, and you will receive a special prize. We are giving you this beautiful bag." And the manager's assistant handed her the bag, and she held up the beautiful bag and gave it to the man. He took it, and indeed, it was a beautiful bag. But it seemed extra light. And so he pulled it down, and he opened it, and he looked inside of it. It was empty. He said, "I'm sorry, there must be some mistake. The bag is beautiful, but it's empty." The manager laughed and she put her arm around the man and said, "It's empty now. But your prize is you get to fill this bag with anything you want in the entire store. Fill it to overflowing, and whatever you put in the bag is yours to take home free of charge because you're our 1 millionth customer. Go ahead." And all the employees clapped, and all the other customers clapped, maybe a little embittered that they didn't come in a few moments later or a few moments earlier. And he took the bag, and he looked at the store. Over to his left was the jewelry section. His wife always wanted a pair of diamond earrings, but they had never been able to afford to buy them. And then he looked over, and he saw the electronics section. His son had been begging him for a Wii. And his daughter wanted the new iPhone so badly. Then he looked over in front of him. There was a huge display of hats. His mother loved hats. How much fun would it be to give her a hat? She hadn't got a new hat in years. And then the sporting goods section caught his eye. And there were a row of graphite fishing rods, extra flexible so he could hook a large fish and reel it in safely. Wow, he would really like to have one of those fishing poles. He sat there for a second imagining how great it would be to get up early in the morning while it was still quiet and no one else was awake, and grabbing his pole and sneaking off to the pond and sitting there for hours fishing, just he and the fish. Oh, that would be wonderful. Then he shook his head and said, "Who am I kidding? I never have time to go fishing. Time. He looked at his watch. Oh my goodness, he didn't realize how long he had been in the store. He just meant to pop in, get something, and pop out. But then all the lights started flashing and the confetti fell, and there he was. He couldn't believe how long he had been there. He had places to go. He had people to see. He looked down at the empty bag. He looked at the store. He looked at his watch. He looked back at the store. His eyes focused on those graphite fishing rods. His eye kind of glanced over at those diamond earrings. Then he shook his head and handed the empty bag back to the manager, said, "I'm sorry. I just don't have time to fill the bag." And he left. Can you imagine such a thing? All those free gifts, his for the taking, and he chose not to fill the bag, but just to leave. Why? He was too busy. He didn't have time. What would you have done? I think I would have stayed and filled the bag. I bet you would have too. Can you imagine having that opportunity and handing the bag back to the manager and leaving? I wonder, have we ever been guilty of this? Of course not, you say. When have we ever even won such a prize? We would never be so foolish. Yet, I wonder, whenever we give into the "I can'ts" or the "I'm too," fill in the blank, then we're guilty of this. We've all been there. We've all made excuses at one time or another why we can't do something, why we're too busy, we're too old, we're too young, we're too rich, we're too poor, we're too tired. And so we've left that bag that God has given us for the fruits of the Spirit and walked away. Dr. King once reminded us that there are no "I can'ts" or "I'm too's." He said, "Everybody can be great because everybody can serve. You don't need to have a college degree to serve. You don't need to make your subject and your verb agree to serve. You only need a heart of grace, a soul generated by love." This is really the heart of today's passage. Paul talks about the fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. The different gifts that God gives us, they are different, the fruits of the Spirit, than other gifts. Other gifts such as teaching and hospitality and music are not given to everyone, at least not in the same measure. But the fruit of the Spirit, those are gifts that are available to all of us, every one of us, in the portion that we need. So how do we receive these gifts? They're given as a result of our walk with God, as we open ourselves to God, spending our time in prayer and study and service, seeking to live faithfully, reaching out in God's name to others, offering them what we have. Then others are blessed and our hearts become open and we become ready to receive these gifts of love and joy and peace and patience and kindness. We become people who are generous and faithful and gentle, developing self-control. We're given these gifts by God so that we can serve more fully. And this is the catch: as we serve, we receive what we need. And they're available to all of us. And they're given abundantly. Unless, of course, we hand the bag back to God empty and say, "No, thank you, God. I'm too busy, too tired, too old, too poor, too rich, too young, too old." Fill in the blank. Or just simply, "I can't." Back to the man who gave the bag to the manager and left the store. Can you imagine the conversation that night between his wife and he? Or maybe the reaction of his children when they heard, "You did what? You gave the bag back? How could anyone not take advantage of such an opportunity?" I wonder. What about us? God is waiting to bless us, to give us the gifts that will strengthen our walk with Christ and our ability to serve. Today you've heard from four who went on a mission trip. If you would like to go on such, keep your eyes open. Opportunities will arise. We will go again next year. And if that isn't the way you are called to serve, there are other ways. As I said before, it's amazing how many opportunities this church has to serve, whether it's preparing meals for next week's St. Paul Soup Kitchen, volunteering at Dwelling Place, helping out with selling pumpkins later this year or Christmas trees, being present at a yard sale or the church fair, or today, helping us with Stop Hunger Now, making 20,000 meals that will change lives. I hope you'll join us. I hope you will open your heart to find the way that God is calling you to serve. I hope you stay today and have a hamburger and then participate in Stop Hunger Now. For there are no "I can'ts," and there really are no "I'm twos." Through the fruit of the Spirit, God gives us a way to serve so we don't have to hand the bag back and go away. We can fill up to overflowing. Thanks be to God. Amen. I invite you to rise as you're able for our hymn. Our hymn is "Christ for the World We Sing."
Oh,
Let us pray. Almighty God, who gives us more than we deserve, you are holy and gracious. Your love reveals your power, and you fill our lives overflowing with the good gifts of your grace, with the fruits of the Spirit, with love and joy and peace, offering us patience and kindness, giving us of your generosity and your faithfulness, that we may be gentle people who have much self-control. And thus we come to you today singing your praises with thankful hearts. We ask that you pour your power upon this church community, that we may serve everywhere faithfully, that we may hear your word and see your mission and go into the world as your people. For there are those who are hurt. There are those who have felt neglect. There are those who have wandered. Be present, O God, that your Spirit may guide us to live lives that are filled with your grace, that we may be the people you created us to be and serve in the ways that you offer us to serve, that the power that we have felt may be felt among others. God, of power and love, we lift up to you those among us who are in need. You have heard our prayers. You know the prayers of our heart and those in our prayer list. We give them into your keeping. O gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for the ways that you have blessed us with healing. Set us on safe ground. May we find your comfort and strength that we may be always and ever thankful. We pray these in the name of Jesus, who gave us the prayer of Christ, the prayer of love. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. God's so good. Let us worship with God with our prayers, our gifts, and our offerings.
God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him from such praise Him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Accept these gifts, O God, and the gifts of our time and service in the next hours. Bless them, multiply them, and use them for your glory in this world. Amen.
Amen.
God's grace and knowing God's peace, you may embody God's joy. Go ahead.